Okay, so welcome everyone to this new episode of Eagle Fly, the experimental debugger. Today we will continue making this awesome debugger, and if you'd like to follow along, please don't hesitate and welcome. Today we'll start by making the disassembler. And yeah, if you have any questions, you can post them on Twitter or YouTube and I'll be there to answer. Alright, so let's go and start with this. I will open the project. That's not the project. Alright, so the last thing we were doing is that we started to disassemble another instruction. In particular, this instruction was an x87 FPU instruction set that I think was, I don't know if we started on it. No, this is the very same, isn't it? Yeah. So yeah, no, we didn't do it, but yeah, we started to read out the spec for the x87 FPU registers and set of instructions. How do they work? Etc. etc. So, in particular, we found out that it's super interesting and super well, it's totally different to what normal GPU instructions, GPIs or general purpose instructions work, you know, because the x87 FPU basically has this notion of a stack inside its data registers. And basically that makes the the ISA and the set of instructions to work in a particular manner, being, let's say, by using relative offsets upon the register where they are, where the, let's say, the stack pointer inside the data register stack is pointing on, you know. So it's kind of a different stuff, you know. So that's what we are looking at today. And yeah, so let's go and see here what's up next. have precision flex, underflow flex, overflow, zero divide, the normalized operand, and the invalid operation. Okay. So, you know, the interesting thing about this stack is that it works like a circular stack, you know? So it's a circular buffer, which basically just keeps adding stuff. It overflows and it just continues on, you know, it resets to the top whenever it has gone to the bottom and over. When the P flag and status were set indicating an Linux that ran the result, the C1 flag set to 1 if the last rounding byte instruction was upward. Oh, cool. So it depends on how does the rounding mode worked. We can see that happen in the status flag. For the control condition code flags. So say C1. Okay. It's right there. Okay. Flurry point tangent, flurry point sine, cosine, sine cosine. Okay, the bit 15 is included for 8087 compatibility only. It reflects the contents of the ES flag. Okay. Okay, so this table is divided into set of instructions. Some instructions as FCOM, like this setting here, make and transform these conditional flags inside the status register in the same way. And this group right here, like FCOM I, FCOM MIP, FCOM ME, FCOM I, FCOM Fukum, Fukumai, Fukumip. They do it in other way. They you don't use, for example, the C0, C3, and C2. They instead use the flex register. The operand class, I don't know what operand class means, but and the sign of the operand itself, which is examining. Okay, FPRAM, FPRAM 1 have the quotient And if it was a reduction complete or reduction incomplete. Q0 or an exception. The roundup or an exception. If there was a source operand within the range, if the source operand it was out of range, and of course if you rounded up the result, you need it to be on inside the range. So what I'm thinking about is like, well, if you see here, this is super interesting. For example, in this case, branching and conditional moves for condition codes in the x87 FPU, looking at the old mechanism, what this tells me is that the branching control and all the conditional movement for the processor, it was tightly coupled with the eflex register, and the in general with the GPR instructions, the general purpose instructions. So what you basically had to do is to have the data from the status flag register or the status flag were being copied onto at least the conditional moves and all the stuff information. You have to copy it on back to the eflex register, which had the control to make the branching. Or, I mean, not the control, but the thing that makes controls the branching, which is the processor itself, need to it was tightly coupled to the eflex register because the processor has access to that register, but it doesn't, or at least in the past, I don't know today, but in the past, the processor didn't have access to the coprocessor x87. So that's in part because of system design, and that's that's interesting, because the more of the system design we know, the more we understand the processor. So that's good. It makes sense because starting up from the back, from the ground up, you the problem of floating point data versus the problem of integer data is totally different, So it has total sense that for solving the problem of floating point data, they isolated the solution, the circuitry, where they have the coprocessor doing all that. A specific floating point logical instruction and stuff, Oh, so yeah, that's why the coprocessor makes the adder for that, and then you just need like a linkage back to the main processor where it has the branch branch control, memory access and stuff like that. So all the main features of the processor were just linked to the coprocessor by a wire, let's say, tune. So whenever you have to, or the whenever you needed to have it was just like an add-on to what it already existed. That was the main processor with for general purpose instructions. So basically, you need F stores status flag or the status word into the AX register, and then whenever it was on the AX register, then you just need to copy that to the eflex register with the SHF instruction. The hacky thing about that is that since it copied the whole 4-bit upper four, sorry, upper 8-bit byte of the status word, you also copy the top pointer from the register, which it was it was like just a wacky thing, probably, you know. I don't know if they did indeed need it, but you know, since the encoding was that, they pass all that information. Oh, do you see? That's the reason why the top is in there, because they have to match the flags in the flag register. So basically, for making these things simpler and not needing to scramble the bits around, they just made the data structure to look pretty much similar to what the flex register has stored into it. So the carry flag is on zero, then the carry flags, which matches the status flag, the condition code C0. C1 is none, which is a one, I guess. C2 is the precision flag. C3 is the zero flag. And yeah, that's all she said. So, and in between, you know, the top of it, which was a copy of it, you know, here's the top register, the top pointer is not used, but it's used as an offset to the zero flag. That's interesting. Which maximum floating point exceptions, that's rounding to the nearest. And 60x87 FPU precision to 64 bits. Okay, so they use the mass the mass bits to control which exceptions can be fired and which don't. So if a bit is set, it cannot be executed. So yeah. So yeah, this number is 178, and it's pretty close to 178.125. But yeah, because it's normalized, that's the representation. And here the exponent is biased with a normalized significant of blah. And this is the way that you transform a decimal number that you normally understand to the encoding of the IEEE single precision format. Yeah, the one is implied here. The bias exponent, I don't remember how it was gotten, but we're gonna remember that. It was something like in the middle thing, you know, so it can go upwards and downwards easily. So this is the encoding for each of these values. Store, yes, set bit integer. This is implied. In the normals, it's not implied. That's why the bytes exponent is not used. So you cannot move it. That's the caveat for the normals. You cannot shift the bytes exponent and have multiple representations of it. And the normals cannot be through. Since they don't use the integer implicitly, and they can shift. So the infinity is still by the exponent bias. Whenever it is so set, you have to have all the bias exponent bit set, the integer value being set as well, and the fraction has to be zero. That's important. And we can differentiate between positive and negative infinity because of the sign. And SNANs and QNANs differ for the most significant bit. And pretty much they can be negative or positive, it doesn't matter. Since they are not numbers, they can be X, yeah, in the sign bit. But they have to be represented as an infinity. But they have to have some value, not zero. So that's interesting. Double extended precision is only available for x87 FPU instruction sets. So when you're working with SIMD, SSC, SSC2, SSC3, SSC4, and AVX, those can't handle double extended precision. That's interesting. So the cool thing, about bias exponents is that it saves a bit, but it saves a bit in different formats. So since it's a square, you know, or double its size, in bigger formats, that would be super useful, rather than on shorter formats where if you add an extra bit, well, you can double just the value. So it's the compound idea that saves that gives the bias constant to be useful. And of course, in that way, yeah, you don't need to imagine, just in the case where we didn't have any bias constant, you will need to represent a negative number on the bias field, you know, or on the exponent field, which it's not necessary at all, because the values are determinative, you know, they are pretty much deterministic, you know. So that, I mean, you can have a better representation. You just have one way to represent it, in this case, a positive value, an unsigned integer, which has this bias idea behind it. Okay, so that's good for remembering this stuff. Let me put it here. and the way the FPU controls how the precision is set, which is the next question. It's like, oh, okay, so how do we control it? Well, we have a specific control register for that, which, and we have a specific precision control field inside the control register, which basically tells the processor how to interact with the data information inside the data registers. So we have single precision, that's 00, you know, reserve 01, 10, 11. Okay. So now I see the difference between rounding toward minus infinite and rounding toward plus infinite. The explanation of it is that when you round to minus infinite, the value that you get is never greater than, you know, it's always going to be less than the infinitely precise result computed. And the other way around, if it's toward plus infinity, the rounded result is going to be closer but not less, never, to than the infinitely precise result. So it's always be greater than, it can be equal, I guess. It can be greater than or equal to the infinitely precise result. And whenever it's towards zero, that means that the result is closest. It's yeah. So it's like the other possibility that it's missing, because if you think about it, you have the two infinites, but it's missing the zero. So how do you round to zero? Well, you have another option there that's round towards zero. So whenever you have a value, that value, the absolute value of it, is never gonna be greater than the infinitely precise result. So that's good, that's good. And basically, run towards zero is the same as truncation because of the mode that it works. Since it's nullifying the precision, you know, it's just setting 0, 0, 0. The sign is respected, but the only thing that we are controlling is the description of it or the significant. So it's just nullifying zeros, boom, 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 nullifying bits. Until it gets to zero, yeah. Whenever you want to get to infinity, that wouldn't nullify zeros. That's not the same as truncation. You because you can either add a bit, I mean set a bit, or you know to the next greater value in the representation, or yeah, because that's for infinity. But for negative numbers, I mean, it will always add value. No. For negative numbers, it will. Well, that's interesting. You have a significant, you start adding values, you have a better representation. It will need to subtract from negative values, isn't it? Because you have to round to, you want to round to the infinity. If it's a negative value, you have to go a less negative value that it's a value that it's closest to zero. So that means that it has to nullify bits. So that's why. So it. It nullifies bits in that case, but rather if it's a positive value, it has to increase the value as well. So it has to
it has now to increase the value, so it adds a bit to the significant, which is interesting. In any other case, I mean, in any case, the way the processor does this, at least from the information that we see here, is that he always takes the two values to, I mean, he always computes both values. So I mean, it's not like, oh yeah, I save processing time because I know which way we're gonna go. It could be, you know, it could be, but I mean, the way the processor does it is like, he always computes the information that he needs, and then he chooses based upon the control flags for the rounding mode, you know. It's like, oh, okay, I went around to this place, because basically you have to choose between those two, and it all depends on the control flags. Yeah, the decision is limited to those two, and that's all. Okay, the RC field is implemented in two different locations, the x87 FPU control register, which is the one we're looking at, and the MXCSR register. Okay, so yeah, they need both of them because x87 is for, I mean, that control register is for x87, and the MXCSR is for the SIMD frame point computations. That's important. and these instructions, the same instructions, basically they automatically truncate the value when they make the conversion from floating point to integers. These are the exceptions. We don't care about the exceptions right now. Let's go back.
This action prevents a program from setting the values in the tag register to incorrectly represent the actual contents of a non-empty data registers. Okay. So that makes all sense. So I think, let me copy this just to finish this. Oof, okay, perfect. So yeah, oh, I didn't know that we opened the project. But yeah, we didn't make any coding. But it doesn't matter. Sometimes that's the way it goes. And yeah. So please, if you have any questions, post them on Twitter or YouTube, and I'll be there to answer. Please make them accordingly to the topic that we discuss on the video, and I'll be happy to answer them. If you would like to follow along, please don't hesitate and be welcome. We will continue making this disassembler, bringing much a little bit more about the x87 FPU core processor and its data transformation instructions and stuff like that. So yeah. So I say thank you very much for coming, and I will see you all on the next stream.